This is State of the Unions. I'm Tim Schlittner.
And I'm Julie Green. Today, I am personally very excited about our guest, the Reverend Leah Daughtry, the CEO of On These Things, who is much more than just the CEO of this company, but a longtime Democratic strategist, faith, social justice, and Democratic Party activist. And we'll get into a lot of that as we go into the interview with Leah. But I think one of the things I'm most excited about on this episode is that we talk to a lot of labor leaders, a lot of electeds about the work that they are doing in terms of organizing and collective bargaining. And today we have the opportunity to talk to a great ally of the labor movement and the work that we do. In addition to her portfolio on these things, Leah heads up a very special project as a consultant for the American Federation of Teachers called Reconnecting McDowell in West Virginia, which we will talk a lot more about. But first, I just want to say welcome.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Thanks so much for being here. Tell us about the Reconnecting McDowell project and why that is so special.
I've been working with Reconnecting McDowell and the American Federation of Teachers now for about 8 years on this particular project. McDowell County, West Virginia is the southernmost county in the state of West Virginia. It's about population 20,000. It is also the eighth poorest county in America. I think we've dropped to number 2 in opioid deaths in the country. So we started there about 8 years ago to see what we could do. Then First Lady Gail Manchin called Randy and said, you know, our schools are failing. They've been under state control for 10 years. Can you help us fix the schools? So Randy went, she took a team and took a look and said, we're teachers. We're the American Federation of Teachers. Of course we can help you fix the schools. This is Randy Weingarten, yeah. The international president of American Federation of Teachers. She said, of course we can help you fix the schools, but unless you look at this as a holistic approach around how we help this community heal and grow, then the schools will just be back to where they were in a little while. So we created this program called Reconnecting McDowell, which is a public-private partnership, about 125 partners now. We started with 10, and now there are 125 West Virginia and national partners who've come together to really help this community rebuild itself, to set their dreams and their intentions and decide what it is that makes for a flourishing community, and then help them to achieve those dreams. At one point, McDowell had been a thriving community of 120,000 people, rich, well-off, middle class, thanks to coal jobs and United Mine Workers, ensuring that everyone had a good wage. And as the bottom fell out of coal and the jobs began to be exported, then the bottom fell out of this community and people no longer were able to make the livings that they used to make. They used to call McDowell Little New York.
Really?
Yeah, because it was such a thriving place. You look at the old pictures and you can just see streets teeming with folks. And there's still some holdover. McDowell County has some of the highest home ownership rates in the state because of the good coal jobs, the benefits of being part of the union. They were able to have the resources to buy their home. So everyone owns their own home there. Now, a lot of the homes are dilapidated because they haven't been able to maintain them after coal pulled out. This is the part of the country that Donald Trump promised them that he was bringing coal back. Well, I haven't seen coal coming back. And these folks voted for Trump out of the hope and the belief in what he was saying to them, that he was going to bring the coal industry back. And that just hasn't happened. In our schools, 90% of the children are school lunch eligible. 90%. There are no jobs. There's just nothing there. It's a difficult circumstance. So we plunged into this with the idea that we would help the community envision a new future for themselves and what could happen if they all work together. So we've been there 8 years now, focused on three areas: improving the schools, creating health and wraparound services, and economic development. And we've had really, really great success thanks to the partners. We've gone from a graduation rate in the mid-80s to now 94% of the kids graduate. All-time high going to college, teen pregnancies down. There are no dentists in McDowell. If you want to go to a dentist, you got to go 90 minutes. So we were able to create partnerships that brings dental vans to the county now, and children can have their teeth checked, and the parents can have their teeth checked. There are no OBGYNs in McDowell. God help you if you're having a baby. You got to plan this thing, because you got to go an hour and a half to see the nearest GYN. Jobs are scarce. The largest employer is the Board of Education. Walmart left McDowell. That'll give you a sense of the kind of poverty that exists there. Walmart can't survive. We've done really well, and thanks to our partners at the AFL and AFL Housing Investment Trust, we just broke ground and are building new housing now in McDowell, the first multi-story housing in 50 years. And we chose to do that because the teacher shortages are so high. We just don't have enough teachers, and part of that is because there's nowhere for them to live. So if you work in McDowell, you are likely living in another county an hour away, and that commute, an hour to work and an hour from work, gets really old. So we thought, let's try to tackle housing and see if we can provide a safe, modern place for new teachers and other professionals to come and to live so that they can be part of the community, begin to build a tax base, be role models in community. And so AFL and AFL Housing Investment Trust have helped us get that funded. We broke ground a little while ago. We were thankful to have Liz Shuler there with us that day, and it's a crowning achievement. The people in McDowell get their lawn chairs and come and sit at the construction site and just watch the building go up every day. Because it's
big deal.
It's a big deal.
Yeah.
I want a lawn chair.
Yeah. That's great.
Watch the construction go up.
You have personal connections to West Virginia?
I do not. I'm from Brooklyn.
Because you're saying we and are, and it seems like you've adopted this as a second home.
It is. It has become a second home. This is probably some of the best and most fulfilling work I've ever done. I'm a Brooklyn girl, as is Randy. What do I know about West Virginia? But
my mom grew up in Bay Ridge.
Oh, yeah. So there you go. I was like, what? And she called me about this, like, West Virginia? Why are you in West Virginia? And she started talking to me about it. I was like, okay, well, I'll go see. Mm-hmm. And the people are the best people, salt of the earth. And they want what everybody wants, which is a way to succeed and achieve and to make your children's futures brighter. And they just want the tools and the resources to be able to live their lives in dignity. So I love it there. I go to West Virginia about once a month, at least, and I have a great time. It's God's country. Those mountains are just everything.
You were honored by the Midwest Academy in 2018 for the work that you've done there. And this just sounds like a huge project. When I first heard of it and it was like, okay, AFT is partnering, I was thinking schools, education, but this really has expanded to building infrastructure, bringing in health services. And really, to me, is just like one of the really shining examples of how the labor movement, the power that it has when it goes into a community. But where did you start 8 years ago when this project was kind of proposed to you and Randy said, Leah, can you come and help us with this?
Well, we started with first, who were going to be the initial partners who would put shoulder to the wheel with us, who would help us imagine what this might be? And of course, the first people to step up was labor, right? So Cecil Roberts with mine workers and a couple others, SEIU there, they all said, okay, what do we need to do? And what we all agreed on was we didn't want this to be big labor coming into a town and telling people what to do. And with our big size 14 sneakers and passing money around and dumping in a bunch of people, what we wanted to do was to support this community's own objectives and let them define what success looks like for them and then support them in that. So the first thing we did was get community people around the table. All the folks that are not-for-profits, small businesses, big businesses, there and say, what do you want? What would make your community thrive? What does a thriving McDowell look like for you? And we listened. And that's all we did was listen. And then as a project manager, then my task was like, okay, so here's what I'm hearing and where's the nexus and where is there similarity of thinking? And we wound up with these three buckets: improving the schools, educational achievement, wraparound services, how do you get folks dental care, health care, social needs, a gym, all those things that make a community thrive, and then economic development. Once we established these are the three areas, this is what we heard, they're falling into these three areas. Now, who's going to work on this?
Right.
And then the community, they picked what area they wanted to work on in terms of subcommittees. We meet every 6 months with the partners. They set their their own goals and they decide what they're going to work on. We're there for support. Where there are big things where a national player might help, then we go get the national player like AT&T or whoever we need that needs to dump some money in there. And then they go and work on those things for 6 months and they come back the next 6 months. They report to each other. Here's what we did. Here's what we weren't able to do. Here's what we're still working on. And here's our plan for the next 6 months. So it's very much community driven. And in that way, we ensure that we're not imposing values. We're not imposing our will, but we're really supporting their own vision of what it looks like. And what it looks like there is not what it looks like in Brooklyn.
Mm-hmm.
We've now begun another program in Rome, New York, and another one in Messina, New York, way upstate. And we're about to do five more.
I was going to ask if this is a model.
Yes. AFT has created a rural task force, and we're going to be doing five more of these.
Right. Rome is more like McDowell than Staten Island.
Yes. And here's the interesting thing, as I said this to you as a New Yorker, when you look at the stats of McDowell, the county in New York that mostly resembles that is the Bronx.
Whoa.
In terms of graduation rates, in terms of all the economic indicators.
What about demographically?
Demographics are different. McDowell is 90% white,
10%
African American. They say they don't have any Latinos. I just think they're not counting because I see them when I'm there.
You see them right there.
Yeah. I see them when I'm there, and they have some of the best Mexican food. And when you go in, it's families, Mexican families who are in there cooking. Yeah. So it's like, so you're leaving somebody out of the count, but okay. And of course, the Bronx, New York, the demographics have totally flipped.
Right.
But all of the data numbers are the same. So it's an interesting construct about how does this notion of poverty and how we think about poverty play out across geographic areas. Now, the difference, you know, McDowell doesn't have public transportation. The Bronx does, right? We got a great public transportation infrastructure you can get around in New York. In McDowell, if you don't have a car or the favored mode of transportation, an ATV, it's hard to maneuver. They've got a one-lane highway. They've been building Robert Byrd Highway forever. It never gets finished. And the mountains cut through. So you have essentially two parts of the county, the Riverview side and the mountain View side, and the mountains cut through. If you're in the Mount View side, the easiest way to get to Riverview side is to leave the state and go through Virginia and go around in order to get to the other side of the county. So you've got this bifurcated system. But the people, they love each other. The biggest rivalry is the Mount View versus Riverview football game. This is the two sides of the county that come together. I think our success in McDowell, and we're not done. We got a lot more work to do. The economic development pieces of it are really tough to crack.
Mm-hmm.
But I think to the extent we've had successes, it's because we saw, the unions as part of the community, right? We weren't people that were just coming in. It's our children. It's our workers. We're invested, our members, whether they're AFTers or the trades or the mine workers. We're not just these union people that stand on the sideline, right? We are part of the community. These are our schools. These are our roads. We're not just about contracts and what works for us, but these are places that we live. And so part of our success, I think, has been that we see ourselves as part of the community, but also we let the community members lead. And we're there for support. We're there for backup. We're there to really help them build the kind of community that they want to have.
Now, this isn't your first parlay with labor. You've worked with the labor movement and quite literally for the Department of Labor. Throughout your career, you're a founder of Power Rising, which is a Black women's conference coming up in April in Baltimore, plug, that has a lot of labor partners. You have a tremendous amount of experience with the Democratic Party, and labor is the backbone, as we say, of the Democratic Party, which we'll talk more about a little later. What do you see January of 2020 and kind of where we are politically, socially? What is the role of labor? You've seen it from such different angles, whether it's in politics or the work you're doing with Reconnecting McDowell. What do you see as someone who's outside of it but works very much adjacent to it? What should labor be doing right now?
You know, I think of labor as the conscience of the American democracy in some sense, because everybody works. This is America where you're expected to work. If there's a job for you, you should have a job. But labor's role, as I see the conscience of the American democracy, is not just have a job, but have a good job, have a safe job, have a job that allows you to achieve the American dream. And labor's role is really to remind us of the value and the dignity of work. It's not enough to have just any old job if it can't help you put your kids through school, if it can't help you buy a house, if it's not safe. We have all these laws. We have weekends because of labor. As we move forward, I think labor has to reinforce reinforce its role and really rebuild its image in the American demographic. I think we in the labor movement have allowed our brand to become one of better contracts for us, better benefits for our members who pay dues. And I think we've got to tweak that some so that all Americans see the value of the labor movement is not just a contract. This is about the mine workers having safe mines. I was the chief of staff at the Labor Department. We ran MSHA, right? So this is about folks in MSHA having mine equipment that allows them to do whatever mining they're doing in a safe fashion so they get home to their families at night. It's about the hospital workers having the protections that they need in order to care for patients and be safe themselves. So we've got to remind people that we're not interlopers. We are part of the community. We're part of the fabric of the community. And no, this is not just about my job and my contract and my benefits. This is about all of us and the kind of community we want to have, the kind of jobs we want our neighbors to have, that we want our children to have in the future. What kind of workplaces do we want for our country? And I think that's what labor has to reclaim as a mantle, reclaim as a message point, that we're here to protect the American worker, regardless of who you are and where you come from.
May I borrow Conscience of the American Democracy, please? Because that is quite fantastic. So President Weingarten of AFT talks about this thing called pension envy, where a worker says, why should you have that, instead of why I don't have that? And I wonder if that's part of the shift you're talking about.
I think it is. I grew up in Brooklyn and I was familiar with labor because many of my church's members were teachers. And you belong to the UFT because you get your benefits. And even now my sisters and my brother are both in the public school system. And I think the right has been very ingenious, as they always are, in casting us in a light, and then we play defense to try to change the narrative. And the right has made it us against them, us with the pensions and the others without. Right? You don't have it. I have it. Why do you have it and I don't have it? As opposed to how can you help me get these same sorts of benefits and achievement? And then all of the right to work and the Supreme Court cases around dues paying and who you're bargaining for has really helped to reinforce that. I believe that labor has to reclaim that mantle and has to reclaim the narrative. As Democrats, we're not good at the narrative side, right? Maybe it's because we're the big tent party. I don't know. And we just let everybody do whatever they want to do. The right is precision, laser focus on narrative. They win the argument before the argument has even started. You see that in the abortion movement when it became pro-life and pro-choice. We're all pro-life, aren't we? Mm-hmm. So how does your movement get cast as pro-life?
Everyone should have the right to work.
And everyone should have the right to work. Yeah. So how does it become right to work versus labor?
Yeah.
That doesn't make sense, but the narrative of that and the languaging of that creates a division and divide where one does not really exist and shouldn't exist. Just in the language, they begin to win before we've even realized there's an argument, right? That there's something going on, and we just got to get better at that.
So I wonder, the labor movement has a very high approval rating in the country. Mm-hmm. The Democratic Party, not as much. You obviously have constituencies both. Is there an argument, you think, for labor to not tie itself so closely to the Democratic Party, to be more independent?
I'm going to say no, because the values of labor are the values of the Democratic Party, and the values of the Democratic Party are the values of labor. The things that the Democratic Party fights for are the same things that labor fights for, right? A living wage, safe workplaces, health care, all kinds of benefits are things that the Republican Party, quite frankly, is trying to end. So why labor would attach themselves to the party that is really trying to undo the things that labor has been fighting for doesn't make sense to me.
No, I wasn't saying attached to the Republican Party. I was saying more loosen the attachment to the Democratic Party, like be more independent from the party system.
Here's what I say as a good Democrat.
Okay. We don't want to get you in trouble.
No, you're not going to get me in trouble. I believe in the Congressional Black Caucus's model. No permanent friends, just permanent interests, right? So I think as a good Democrat, there have been times I voted for a Republican because I just thought that my values aligned better. And the values that the Republican and the legislation that the Republican candidate was talking about, I'm not talking about presidential, but, you know, in my state, were better to me than what the Democrat was talking about, which just, you know, and you know they had to be talking crazy if I was crossing over, right? So I think labor has to have a certain alignment to the interests of, and whoever's better aligned to the interests, then I don't think any of us, any voter, can be blindly tied to any candidate or any political party. I think that goes for labor too. Even if you look through that lens, labor would naturally wind up more on the Democratic side than the Republican side, just because of the values and the interests align better there than they do on the other side.
Yeah. And I don't want to focus too much on the Democratic Party, but mm-hmm. I can't have you here at this podcast and not talk about just how much experience Leah has within the party, not just as an activist, but as a leader. You have been chief of staff of the Democratic National Committee. You are the only person, first and only woman and African-American woman, to have run two Democratic National Conventions, including this past one in Philadelphia in 2016, which has largely been dubbed as the best one. I'm going to say it was the best one. I worked with you on it. You are on the Rules Committee of the Democratic Party, which is, it's the Rules Committee. They determine the rules. You are part of a group affectionately known as the Color Girls, who have written a book.
The Color Girls who have considered politics.
Who have considered politics, which is full of stories of just your intersections with social justice movement, but also with the party and the experiences that you, Donna Brazil, Mignon Moore, and Yolanda Caraway have had from all different backgrounds of how you kind of came together in this. You meet with all of the candidates as they, and have been meeting with them as they have gone through this primary system. So you all really sit at the table. But one of the things I really don't want to miss is your connection to faith and the role your faith has played in all of this. And you recently became bishop of the historic House of the Lord Church in Brooklyn. And I just wanted to take a moment and just ask you, how has your faith informed all of these different things that you have done, from Reconnecting McDowell to your activism, and how it will guide you moving forward?
My faith is easily the most important thing in my life. It is the foundation of everything that I do, and it informs everything that I do in terms of my values, in terms of the work that I choose, the projects I choose, the partners I choose. And that is because I grew up as a pastor's kid. I'm a fifth generation pastor myself. We go back to the days of enslavement. And what is apparent to me from growing up, Sunday school teacher, usher, choir director, you name it, all of the things that I did as a kid growing up. But when I was able to make my own choice, I went to college in New Hampshire, Dartmouth College, the cold hills of New Hampshire. And I was on my own, and I had to decide about my faith away from my parents, away from my family. And it was clear to me that my connection to God, my connection to the values that I find in my holy text would be the guiding principle for me. So the things that I find in my text about caring for those who are not like me, reaching and extending myself to those of same and different experience. And that mostly my text informs me that I'm called to love. I'm not called to understand, because there are many things I don't understand, but I'm called to love everyone, even and probably especially those who are not like me. And to extend myself as a living representative of the grace and the mercy and the justice and the righteousness of the living God. That's my calling. And so whether that leads me to working in McDowell with people who are not like me, but who are just like me, we all want the same things, or whether that leads me to my work with Black women's empowerment, or whether that leads me to faith organizing ministers, it all grows out of an understanding that I am the embodiment, and I should be the best representative I can be of who God is, but also that God calls me to ensure that everyone experiences the living presence of God, and that everyone, every living person, is a divine representative of this God that I love. And so if they're divine representatives, it's my responsibility to ensure they have clean water and clean air and good schools and safe environments, because isn't that where the divine representative of God should live? Isn't that where each of us as God's representative should have? What would we say to the living God if he or she walked in here now? You can't drink the water and you can't breathe the air, and it's okay if your children have asthma and that you can't get to a doctor, or you have to have this much money in order to live this place or to have this kind of health care. That's not what we would say to our God. And so I choose to see, and my faith advises me to see, each person as breathing We call it the rhema breath, the divine breath of God. And in that sense, you're holy and I'm holy. And it sums up in this one little phrase, treat the people's needs as holy. Treat the people's needs as holy. If you are the living breath of God, then what you need to live and survive and thrive is holy. And if I'm going to treat the offering plate and the building as holy, then I treat your needs as holy too. What you need to thrive and to live as God intended for you to live. And so that's what drives me. And that's why I pick the projects that I do and the partners that I do and people who are aligned with my own values. And it's never for me about the size of the contract or the size of the check, but it's about, are we aligned on values and vision first? Now let's talk about the money.
Gotta eat.
Pay the bills. I got nephews and now a grandniece. You know, they got colleges coming up. So, but it's to be aligned on values and vision and how we want to get that done.
Do you think God speaks through people?
Absolutely. How else would God speak these days? I mean, she or he is not walking the earth except through us. So, of course, God uses people and speaks through people.
And are you a believer that everything happens for a reason?
Everything in divine order, yeah.
Maybe we could wrap up with some stuff about West Virginia. Sure. Get back to that for a second. One of the topics we've had on this podcast a number of times, including we just had a conversation with the president of the firefighters, is the scourge of addiction going on in this country right now. I wonder if you've been able to see that close up in McDowell County and what it looks like and what do you think we can do to combat it?
You know, when we first went, we made the poor assumption that the biggest problem we would see would be meth. Mm. And we were wrong, really wrong. The biggest problem was opioids, prescription drugs, and the prescription drug mills that happen in that part of southern West Virginia where people can get just pills. It's just pills and pills and pills and pills. In fact, I think at the third year we were there, one of the mayors in one of the towns, about 12 different towns in McDowell, one of the mayors was killed by his daughter-in-law for his prescription drugs. And I don't think that's any different than any other places in America that are dealing with this problem. So there's a policy side of this, which is shut down these prescription mills and these doctors who are writing hundreds and hundreds of prescriptions. That ought to be illegal.
Criminals.
Total criminals. Yeah. And they know that no one person can be taking all these pills, so it's got to be a mill.
Yeah.
So the policy on just shutting that down so it's not possible for that to happen. But I think then there's a human element of this is an addiction that must be treated as a healthcare problem and not simply as lock them all up. So additional funding and additional methods for folks to get the treatment that they want. There are no treatment facilities in McDowell. So if you have the best of intentions and you want to get off the drugs, there's no way for you to do it. So this is across the country. What do we do as an American society with folks who have this kind of addiction that drives them then to criminal behavior, that drives them to child abuse and other kinds of things? Do we just let it go? Do we just say it's okay? Or do we ensure that every state, city, neighborhood has the resources that it needs to provide these people with the health care that they need in order to shift this narrative?
Should labor be talking about building a rehab in McDowell?
I think we've got to talk about how we get treatment facilities. And it's not just McDowell, it's the whole cluster. So, you know, someplace that you can send people who need help. Right now, there is nowhere to send people who need that kind of support. And labor as a good member of the community, and these are our children. These are our nephews, our cousins who are having these problems. We're part of the community. We have to help our communities heal. The places where we live and thrive. We have to help the folks there have the kind of lives we want to have, which is not to say, let's be real, some of our members are struggling with this.
Yeah.
And they're struggling with this. What do we want to provide for them? And what we want to provide for them, we should be willing to provide for the entire community.
Well, I want to say thank you.
Thank you.
For giving us some of your time today. I know you have a very busy schedule, but also for giving us a sense of what allied work looks like from the ground up and how you've come to this. It's been an interesting conversation. It's taken us places that we haven't gone on this podcast before, which I really appreciate.
I want to tell y'all one story.
Yeah.
In 2008, when I was the CEO of the convention and we were trying to decide where to go, and our choice, we had narrowed down to Denver and I can't even remember the other city. And we knew that Denver was not a labor state.
Hmm.
There were no union hotels downtown. Before we made the decision, we called Mr. Sweeney. We called Unite Here. I can't remember who it was then. I said, look, this is what it is.
Wilhelm, maybe?
Wilhelm. This is what it is. We don't have any good choices here. help us figure this out. And this is what allyship looks like. And what they said is, look, there's no labor hotels, which made all of us uncomfortable. It's like, okay, so what can we do? And what we came up with as allies was, when we signed the contract, we went back to Denver and said, you don't have any union hotels. That's a problem for us. This new hotel you're building at the airport, you got to make it union. We wanted in their contract that it will be a union hotel when it's built. This Hyatt downtown that you want to be the headquarters, you got to make it union. Your night here's coming in. Mm. It's got to be a union facility. Mm-hmm. And if you can't do that, we're not coming. So, you know, there was the struggle in labor that there are no union hotels. Okay, but how are you going to get some?
Yeah.
How are you going to get it? You got to get a toehold in here. Because if we can say we're not coming, and then you still won't have any union hotels, mm-hmm. and you're still not building your movement. So let's do this as a way for you to get a toehold in. Let the other hotels see what this one is doing, and that this is not the big bad wolf coming to tear your industry apart. And so that's what we did. And so as a result, by the time the convention came, which was about 18 months later, record time, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. You had one new hotel that was completely union from the beginning, and you had the downtown Hyatt, which became union. And so Unite Here was able to get in there and start organizing. And then we said, and we want organizing campaigns in all of the other hotels, which means you have to let us bring our people in and talk to the workers, slide the cards under the doors and all of that, because that's what we want to do to help labor build in this arena. And it worked mm-hmm. out great. As labor builds and grows and thinks toward the future, maybe it's not so hard and fast to line. Maybe there's a creative way.
Yeah, use some leverage.
To leverage things yeah. like this in order to build the movement.
But only because we have good allies, because convention is a 4-day event, but the leave behind.
Right. The leave behind.
The leave behind is yeah. that now you've got a couple more hotels in mm-hmm. Denver mm-hmm. that are unionized. That
and the ramp up, which is every project we do in this arena has to be union. I don't know where you're going to get them from, but you're going to have to go out to the neighboring counties, mm-hmm. to the neighboring states if you have to hire IATC and the building trades and the electrical, all those folks that we have to build a convention. You got to get them as part of the contract. And, you know, Denver's not a place where all of that infrastructure exists, but they had to go get it, which helped to build the labor movement in that part of the country.
We've been talking with Reverend Leah Daughtry, a friend and ally of the labor movement, and is doing incredible work in West Virginia and beyond. Thanks so much for being with us today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
This is State of the Unions.
Everybody, this is Gabrielle Carteris, and you just listened to another wonderful episode of State of the Unions. Never miss an episode by subscribing now on iTunes, Spotify, Google Play, or wherever you get your podcasts. And go ahead, give them a rating while you're at it. Go on, give them all the stars. Go on. Okay.